Okay, so so what if so don't want to exclude this. So in the general case, if H2 is not equal to zero, so then so then it's not a smooth variety, it's not a manifold, but well, unfortunately it's a derived scheme. Which I'm not going to get into what that is. So anyway, those things make perfect sense. But so this short exact, so now it's not a short exact sequence anymore. So now I've got this five-term sequence, and really I should write that instead. So let me write this H1 of M, that term, which used to be the tangent bundle at the point E, the tangent space, now it turns into the tangent complex at the point E. I mean, derived schemes don't have tangent spaces, they have tangent complexes. This is a complex in the derived category of M. Okay, so but like the term in degree zero of this tangent complex is this one, then that maps to the tangent complex of S at the point E. And then right, then I have this term here, which is the relative. So it's like I can call it like the virtual tangent complex, virtual normal complex, I guess. That is just and because of the shift and the indices there, this is like the shift of the relative tangent complex M over S. So and this whole sequence here, okay, so this sequence is self-dual, right? If I take the dual, I get the same thing back, which means, as is also true in the derived category, if I take the dual of this is a distinguished triangle. If I take the dual of everything, I get, so this is, now I wrote it as the relative tangent complex. One dual, let me maybe write the dual minus one like that. I just took the dual of this triangle and wrote it below, and then I get the isomorphism. So this thing is self-dual. And the derived category. Okay. And so that's basically this is what's known as a virtual Lagrangian. I mean, I'm of course really throwing away a lot of things because, I mean, the symplectic structure is more than just a pairing on cohomology, right? I also need that closeness of the corresponding one form, and those kind of things are more complicated. But the first order, this is what's going on. So I have the symplectic manifold in the middle, where the tangent space is identified with its dual, and then the Lagrangian has this property that its tangent complex is identified with a shifted relative one. And so that's like the derived enhancement of this sequence for Lagrangian submanifold being self-dual. So this is the kind of thing that makes sense. geometry. So, yeah. Maybe we'll erase this sequence. So, let me just see, so. Yeah, so in the picture where I have like a three manifold and like a co-borders in between two manifolds, right? I have like my modulus base for M, which is curly M, magnitude, the modulus base for S. And right, this sequence that I wrote down basically gives rise to the fact that then in fact n, this is a virtual Laplacian correspondence. And if I have the opposite kind of thing where I have two manifolds in the middle, so two, three manifolds glued to a two manifold. And then I get so the modulus for sigma, this is my symplectic, and then so in this case I have a Lagrangian correspondence from the point to S, right? The point corresponds to here. It's really just a Lagrangian, it's like S, and so that's what I just explained up here. This sequence gives that. Another sequence like that gives that. And then so M is the composition of these two Lagrangian correspondences, which is just the final product. Right? So a local system on M is a local system on the two parts which with a gluing on the overlap. So that's this diagram. So here's my Lagrangian intersection. So even so, if I'm in a situation where this map is injective, H1 of M to H1 of S, so I have a immersed Lagrangian and another immersed Lagrangian or two Lagrangian submanifolds, and this is a Lagrangian intersection. So intersection of two Lagrangians. So M is a Lagrangian intersection. To see that always the thing that we associate to a closed three manifold is always going to be a Lagrangian intersection. You can write it in many different ways as a Lagrangian intersection. And if I an example, of course, would be that I could take M1 equal to M2, so I'm looking at the double, and in that case, I get the same Lagrangian manifold, and then M is equal to M1, M equal to M2, and so that would be an example of the self-intersection, but there's absolutely no reason why I shouldn't be allowed to consider that.
Okay, but this fiber diagram with M1 and M2,
yeah.
Is this a theorem of an isomorphism of Dirac stats or something?
It's the Seifert-Fain-Campbell theorem, right?
But is it also an isomorphism of Dirac stats in general?
Certainly, yes.
In that sense, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, and of course, in the end, yeah, it's the stats. Okay, so what did I want to say here? So the gist is here. So for the closed manifold. Closed and three manifolds. And so they go to. They go to Lagrangian intersections. but we should also be able to think of this Lagrangian intersection as a Lagrangian correspondence from the point to the point. So, so this is the same thing as a Lagrangian correspondence. So, in other words, it's a virtual Lagrangian over the point. And if I look at my definition of virtual Lagrangian over the point, so when my symplectic manifold is the point, then this is zero. So this is zero. So this is the same as that shifting. So actually, So S is trivial. So the relative M over S is actually just M. Right. So I have this S. So I have an isomorphism of the tangent complex with the dual of the tangent complex shifted. So that's why it's a shifted. So that's why it's minus one shifted. There's an isomorphism from the tangent goes to the tangent complex goes to the minus one shifted tangent complex is an isomorphism. And so it's dual.
Do you say M is smooth? This might be zero or something.
M is smooth. No. Yeah, so. I mean, it's typically not zero. I mean, it could be. It could be anything. All it means is that this is zero, and these two things are isomorphic, and those two things are isomorphic.
No, I mean, M is smooth, and S is a point.
Every smooth. Every Lagrangian intersection is an example of a minus one shifted symplectic. So let me just read it. So every Lagrangian intersection is a minus one shifted symplectic star. So now, an actual Lagrangian intersection of two Lagrangian, so every Lagrangian intersection is a minus one shifted symplectic stack, and every minus one shifted symplectic stack is locally a Lagrangian intersection. But if I'm just interested locally, locally, if I have a Lagrangian submanifold and a symplectic manifold, I can just locally make the symplectic manifold the cotangent bundle of the manifold. Let's say this, and the embedding the zero section, and then my other Lagrangian becomes a closed one form. And actually, since I'm working locally, why not just say an exact one form? So for some function, so where F is some kind of holomorphic function on the smooth manifold. Whenever I have a Lagrangian intersection locally, it's the critical locus. So the intersection of these two things are this, the vanishing locus of df, square df. This is, yes, this is the dimension of this dx, so then this becomes a scheme theoretically critical locus of x. So it reminds is locally Lagrangian reflection and locally critical locus of a holomorphic function on a smooth line, smooth complex line. So in particular, this means that you have the moduli space of irreducible local systems on a three-manifold that locally is the critical locus of a function. Of course, it's in some sense. That was a good. So if M is a okay, so now let's so let's see. This is like the derived scheme, and somehow the derived structure encodes this. And this is the derived scheme. This is just the underlying classical scheme. And so this is really the scheme of local systems. Whereas this somehow is some enhanced version which keeps track of the fact that this thing is locally the critical locus of some function. If you're just looking at the critical locus, it's contained inside some smooth manifold, but that ambient smooth manifold is not part of the structure. So if you want to, you have to some way to talk about how to glue these critical loci together. Anyway, so this function nu, right? This was constructed a function that I talked about earlier. So now let me say some more things about it. So it's new. There's the function on this classical scheme. So for this function, you don't need the derived symplectic structure, as I actually told you at the beginning. But so this is the constructed function. So it's already set. So if m bar is smooth, then this constructible function of the scheme at the point phi is minus 1 to the dimension. If m happens to be a product, constructible function on each factor, I can pull them both back to the product and take multiply them together. But the interesting property is that if m is the critical locus of f, then nu bar at point p is minus 1. So I always need some ambient.
Because you have to get some sort of local weight, is that right?
Yes. So I want to say that it's just my notation problem. So m is, I should probably not use m here. Okay, so this is my holomorphic function, and this M bar is, or this M is like a derived critical locus of S, and M bar is just the steam theoretical critical locus of F. So really just the classical final product, as it's explained in Hartshorne. That's this.
Can I ask a naive question?
Yeah.
So why is it -1 to the dimension of M bar? How did you arrive at that?
Well, it's a special case of this formula here.
Okay.
Well, that doesn't explain it either. So there's the -1 to the dimension of the ambient smooth manifold times 1 minus the Euler
characteristic. Euler characteristic, right.
Of the Miller fiber. So you have your smooth manifold, you have a holomorphic function to C, you take it, so you assume that P goes to the origin, and then you take a nearby fiber intersected with a small ball around P, and that gives you the Miller fiber. But it's actually a theorem, a fact, that even though this looks like it depends on this, on the way you write the scheme as a critical locus, this value actually does not depend on the way you do it. It only depends on the scheme structure of this of the intersection. So you don't need the fact that you have a Lagrange intersection. You just have an intersection. So when you forget about all the orientations, you still have just an intersection and just a scheme, and you have this well-defined number. I mean, so if you don't have these, then there's some other definition of this using local Euler obstructions and stuff. And it's like a. So I wanted to, of course. Well, in the arithmetic analog that I'm hoping that we're all hoping to come through. Well, let me just say that. So the arithmetic analog. So we take some kind of number field, so this, let's say this totally imaginary, so I don't have to deal with the infinite primes, mu p is in there, and so then I want to, so let's say, so my three manifold with boundaries, so n comma sigma, should now correspond to like spec rho k minus s. Three manifold with boundary, yeah, and that my my closed two manifold, and so yeah, if I wanted to find okay, so.